And the film's director and producer are here with us now, Jim and Jackie Heltz from Williston, Vermont, a father and daughter filmmaking team.
That's correct.
Welcome. It's nice to have you here.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Jackie, we see at the end of the documentary that there is a dedication to your aunt, Pat, who had ALS and died last year. Is she why you decided to make this film?
Exactly. So the film is dedicated to my aunt Pat O'Shea. She was diagnosed with ALS in the summer of 2016, and her battle with ALS ended in January 2018, and she's the catalyst for this film. We had been participating in the Walk to Defeat ALS, and were involved in the Northern New England ALS chapter for many, many years leading up to that. We're kind of thinking of maybe stepping back and taking a break, and learned of her diagnosis, and decided to participate in the walk, and at the walk got the opportunity to speak to actually a friend of hers, Jim Glibicki, and his partner Joe McKay, and they had been working with this researcher and neurologist, Dr. Elijah Stummel at Dartmouth-Hitchcock, and they had kind of brought up these questions, had seen some connections, and I was introduced to this concept, this possible link between this cyanobacteria or blue-green algae and sporadic cases of ALS through them, and then after that spoke to more members of the ALS Association who all knew about this work that at the time was totally new and unfamiliar to me, and I think that might have been another an introduction for my aunt as well, who I think kind of started asking those questions at that point. You hear these really compelling and kind of almost scary stories about these connections. Jim Glibicki had been working on a property out in Shelburne Point since 1990. And the owner of that property, David Schroyer, had died of ALS. A year later, this man was diagnosed, and I had heard that story at the walk and had to think, well, what does that mean? And I don't think that they felt that their cases of sporadic ALS really just came out of nowhere. I think the connection was pretty obvious.
And Dr. Stummel has suspected this for a number of years. He's the leading researcher on this, who we meet
That's
in the
correct.
Documentary.
And what he saw, he was seeing these clusters around lakes, and he didn't really understand why until somebody mentioned, well, you know, all those lakes have a lot of algae blooms around them. And he's like, oh, and that was the starting point. And they started doing the research. I think down the road, if this all comes to pass, I'm sure a lot of people are going to be looking closer about blue-green algae in their areas and whether there's ALS clusters.
The researchers are certainly working on it. They have their ongoing projects to try to determine whether we're seeing the cyanobacteria spreading from the lake, getting in the air, and going beyond to neighboring homes and communities. But is the sense you got making this documentary that we're doing enough to investigate this?
I think anything that we saw is definitely preliminary. It's starting on a path that I think will make a lot of sense to continue on. When you're seeing, based on a population, there should be 10 cases of ALS in this area, in this cluster, and instead there's 55. There should be 2 cases, but actually there's 25. That's startling, and I think that's a line of questioning that's worth following through on. There's definitely initiatives that are starting and are coming out of this research through UVM, through Dartmouth-Hitchcock, that will continue, but I don't think that work has been completed yet, and I think the researchers who are involved would agree with that.
As we heard from the state toxicologist, no strong, firm data. Lots of suspicions, a lot of things that make people ask questions, but no hard data, conclusive data at this point.
That's true, but the state health department did feel compelled to put a warning about the possible link between blue-green algae and ALS on their website. So there must be some sort of red flag that they said, well, just in case, we're just letting you know that there's been research out there and there's thinks there might be a connection. Like Jackie said, this is the early stages of this research. And I think, but it's sort of going in that direction. I mean, Dr. Jeff Cohn, he's saying that originally, he goes, you know, putting pins on a map is one thing. But he goes, but now they're starting to get the evidence and collecting the data that it's starting to be fairly compelling.
Do they believe it's only a matter of time that they'll be able to prove a link?
I think that seems to be the case. There's a lot of use with this sort of satellite and sort of kind of spatial modeling, using regression models, and as more of that research comes together, there's a lot of what Dr. Stummel calls a compelling narrative, like in the story of David Schroyer and Jim Glubicki. That's a very compelling narrative. When you start to have more numbers in place, I think that that will kind of solidify those hunches.
We know they've been doing research on Mascoma Lake in New Hampshire for a number of years, and, mm-hmm. and Lake Champlain. Are they doing research on Lake Carmine or some of the other lakes around the Northeast, New York, Vermont, New Hampshire, where there is a lot of blue-green algae?
Lake Mascoma had really startling information, especially when you think about aerosolization. There might be someone who says, I've never eaten a fish from that lake, I've never swum in that lake, and I don't get my drinking water from that lake, but I do live a mile, half a mile away. What's going on? Lake Carmine, I guess, through Senate Bill 260, has now been considered the first lake in crisis in Vermont history, which is pretty startling, and I think is going to be the subject of a lot of future research.
We saw the state taking the water samples, testing the water, mm-hmm. but does the state feel compelled to also test air samples, like the researchers are doing, to sort of get a feel, to get maybe some hard evidence of whether or not we're seeing cyanobacteria in the air?
I think from what I understand right now, a lot of it is sort of boots on the ground sampling directly from the lakes themselves. And I think the next big push will probably be moving towards this consideration of aerosolization, especially when we realize that kind of that, if it's not just water ingestion, if it's not from food exposure or from dermal contact, what is that other piece that's maybe pushing this to be a bigger problem?
Had it been this bad when Pat was living there, or has all this just been within the past few years that it's gotten to this degree?
Well, they've always had a problem on that lake this.
Enough to start research, but I think the past few years, it's just, if cyanobacteria is sort of nutrient-driven, it's based on an influx in phosphorus that's kind of put into overdrive by human activity, and also things like warming waters. The water in Lake Champlain and Lake Carmine is like 7 degrees warmer than it was when this research began. An influx in storms that creates more runoff and churns the water.
Churns it up, that's it, that's the problem.
Those kind of recent phenomenons are creating a situation that's sort of been unheard of for the decades.
More so than the phosphorus itself, because really Vermont has been taking steps to restrict phosphorus use, cut back on when and where manure can be spread, and really trying to tackle the nutrient loading and the phosphorus getting into the water and triggering the blue-green algae blooms. So is the thought that the weather has a lot to do with it?
I think it's a combination. But plus, you know, this is a 200-year history of this happening. I mean, though the people are cutting back, you know, industrial runoff, homes polluting, farmer runoff and stuff. But this has been going on a long, long time. And of course, the lake gets to a saturation point. But the thing is, it's in there. And because of, like you said, the weather, this churning, just, it's like a perfect storm of all these things happening. And that's why we have the blooms we're having.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the lake in crisis and the Senate bill. Does that provide some concrete steps to try to deal with this and tackle it?
From what I understand, it's a start. It's a bill that deems Lake Carmine a lake in crisis, and it deems that we need to continue research and start this big lake cleanup, but there's not a defined funding source, which I think is the biggest shortcoming of these two bills. It's S-260 and H-576. It's exciting that we have these two bills, but without a concrete funding source, they are a bit, they're more flimsy, I guess, than people would have originally desired.
And you mentioned when it comes to ALS, it doesn't get as much attention as many other terminal illnesses, although it was about 4 years ago in 2014 that everywhere we saw the ice bucket challenges. They went viral, those mm-hmm. videos, which certainly raised awareness and I think raised more than $100 million for research. Do we know if any benefit from that will go to these researchers, whether they will see any of those funds to help with their work?
Well, Dr. Stummel has gotten a grant from that, some of that money, so he's benefited.
ALS is a disease that unfortunately is pretty far behind a lot of other diseases, and as far as what we know, there's no known cure or definitive cause or viable treatment, where a lot of diseases we learned a lot about at the turn of the century. That kind of came about for ALS in like the 1950s and even early 1990s. So a lot of research right now that's being benefited by the ice bucket challenge is just identifying biomarkers or doing learning more about basic what genes, or four new genes that were discovered to be related to familial cases of ALS through the ice bucket challenge money. But yeah, on this very comprehensive list, there is really only one that's related to cyanobacteria, and that's Dr. Stummel.